Greetings, everyone, and welcome to the Radical Mutation radio program broadcasting live from Hebbel Am Ufer and streaming on the How4 online platform.
Radical Mutation.
We are Born Free Empowerment Radio and Nyabinghi Lab welcome you to this immersive program of performance, dance, conversations, visual installations, comedy, music, and film.
The program Radical Mutation on the Ruins of Rising Suns forges bridges between historical struggles for equality, anti-racism and representation in arts and culture, and current efforts for radical change in cultural spaces.
Radical Mutation.
Yes. Wow, this is exciting. We are Born Free Empowerment Radio Mix. How I'm... Wow. Dear lovely people, friends and enemies, we invite you all to join us at How from 23rd of September until the 4th of October.
Hello, Leute, beautiful people. We are Born Free Empowerment Radio with collaboration with How Nummer 1. Welcome to you for a live performance, talk shows from the 23rd up till on the 4th. Come and join with us. Happy time, lovely moment. Woohoo!
On tonight's radio session, we introduce British scholar Robbie Aitken. His research interests include the history of Black diaspora in Germany, European colonialism, and constructions of race in pre-1945 Europe. He has published widely on Germany's first Black community, including Black Germany, The Making and Unmaking of a Diaspora's Community, 1884 to 1960. His current work looks at Black compensation claims made in the aftermath of the Holocaust. Tonight, he will introduce us to the beginnings of Germany's first Black theatre, Sunrise in Morningland, from 1930. On the second slot, we have Listening to Pungwe, the joint project of the Namibian historian Memory Biwa and the sound artist Robert Mercury, dealing with German colonial history in their radiophonic lecture performance, Simon Zangara, a spectral figuration of archival voices. The story is about Kingitile Bokero Ngwale, who, obsessed with the spirit medium Hongo, recruits fighters against the German invaders. The artist overlay vinyl recordings from several decades with songs, poems, and momentary gestures into the past, and invite listeners to collectively hear and feel that which is invisible.
Sonnenaufgang in Morgenland, a Black German performance of diaspora and resistance. In January 1930, an eye-catching notice appeared in the influential African-American newspaper, the Baltimore Afro-American. This announced the creation of a race theatre in Berlin, Germany, which, according to the notice, was to be a cross between a dramatic theatre and a review. The information had been sent to the newspaper by the Cameroonian Victor Bell, Dai Ndumbe. Bell was the president of the League for the Defense of the Negro Race, which was behind the project. The League was a newly formed, transnationally networked, radical, anti-colonial group based in the German capital. The culmination of its theatrical efforts would be the revue show Sonnenaufgang in Morgenland, Sunrise in Morningland, or Sunrise in the Orient, starring and written by one of its members, Bibi Mphisa, and staged in Berlin in December 1930. Very little material pertaining to the project exists. As far as we know, there is no surviving script. There's no first-hand evidence from those involved. Instead, we're almost entirely dependent on a handful of reports in African-American, German, Austrian, Dutch, Danish, and British newspapers. They help us to at least reconstruct elements of this initiative. This, though, is a problem, not simply the lack of primary materials, of archival sources, but but the materials themselves. The limited European coverage is full with contemporary racial stereotypes, and it has to be read against the grain. While the African-American press tended to depict Black Germans as idealized, aspirational figures to the US readers. Nonetheless, the very fact that Germany's Black community could successfully realize this remarkable theater project during the twilight years of the Weimar Republic make this a story worth trying to recover. We should see the project as both an expression of a diasporic identity in the making, as well as one of resistance. Resistance against dominant stereotypes of Africans in Africa, as well as resistance against a right-wing backlash towards Black performers and Black cultural forms in the late Weimar period. We'll start by setting the scene through discussing Germany's Black presence in the late 1920s and the early 1930s. Then we'll look at the group behind the project, before turning to the link between performance and politics, and finally to Sonnenaufgang Morgenland itself. In the late 1920s, there were around 250, perhaps as many as 500 Black residents, including their German-born children, living in Berlin. The majority of the first generation of arrivals were men who'd come from Germany's African colonies, primarily the port city of Douala in Cameroon, but also from Togo and from Tanzania. Most had arrived pre-1914, and few, if any, had ever intended to stay. But following the outbreak of war and the subsequent Versailles peace settlement, which stripped Germany of its overseas empire, the opportunities for returning home were all but ended. Neither German citizens nor citizens of the new mandate authorities who'd inherited the German colonies, so largely the French and the British, we should perhaps see these men, their children, and their wives as stateless. With these now former colonial subjects effectively stranded in Germany, unable to return to Africa, an unforeseen byproduct was the emergence of a more permanent and stable Black community. Both pre and post-war, there were pockets of Black residents in the likes of Hanover and Munich, but in particular Hamburg, and moreover Berlin, emerged as key centres of migration. In these, Black people were increasingly visible to one another, as well as to outside observers. They frequently lived and worked close to one another, in environments and situations and under circumstances that promoted association. A conviction of common interest developed, the shared experiences of racism or colonialism, and the difficulties of economic and social survival in Germany. This helped create bonds among Black diasporic people. People who were otherwise often separated by geography, separated by the customs and varying languages that they brought with them to Europe. But by the end of the wartime period, informal and formal Black social and political organizations reaching throughout Germany had been formed. Their composition, their membership, extended beyond former colonial subjects to also include men and women from other parts of West and East Africa, from the United States, and from the Caribbean. A clear expression of this community building, of these networks, is the League for the Defense of the Negro Race, the group behind the theatre project. It can be seen as part of a longer tradition of Black self-help organizations in Germany, which would also include the earlier Hamburg-based African Welfare Association, Afrikanischer Hilfsverein, created in 1918. The League in Berlin was established in September 1929 by six Douala men from Cameroon, including both Victor Bell and Bibi Mpisa. It was created against a backdrop of increasing economic crisis and rising racial prejudice, which was greatly impacting upon the lives of Black Germans. From the very beginning, it was pan-African, both in terms of its membership and in terms of its outlook. Membership was open to all people of African heritage, as well as white wives. And various reports suggest that there were around 30 to 50 members, including several women. Members were living largely, but not exclusively, in Berlin. Most were from Cameroon, but several Togolese men also appear to have been involved. And as well as offering support for German-based black people, among other things, the group's aims called for the emancipation of people of African heritage worldwide and the express support for exploited populations in the Caribbean and the United States. Furthermore, black Germans were encouraged to join German trade unions. The language used in the group's documents, the language used in their aims, speaks to the influence of both the Communist International in Moscow, as well as to wider, related, and developing international networks of Pan-Africanism. The group was formed in the presence of the French Sudanese radical Timoko Garankuyate, secretary of the similarly named organization, the League for the Defense of the Negro Race, which was based in Paris. With others, Kuyate was striving to create a network of black activists throughout Europe, and the League in Berlin would become a sister organization. Kuyate had likely gained access to Africans in Berlin through the influential communist organizer and the propagandist Willy Munzenberg. Munzenberg, too, had been actively seeking to establish contact to colonial subjects in Europe to help mobilize them against colonial oppression. And it's through his efforts that the group came into the orbit of the Communist International, the Comintern. But a commitment to anti-racism and black liberation was not simply dictated by these outside partners. German-based blacks had a longer history of anti-colonialism and of speaking out on behalf of African interests, both in Germany and in Africa itself. This included attempts to intervene in post-war discussions concerning the fate of Germany's African colonies, as well as in expressing public concern at the growth of anti-black propaganda, the so-called Schwarzer Schmach, in the light of German protests concerning French use of colonial troops in the Rhineland in the early 1920s. A German press report from 1930 picked up on the active interest that the Berlin's black community showed in the developing black internationalist movement in this Pan-Africanism, suggesting that African-American newspapers, as well as foreign language black newspapers, were being read and discussed. Indeed, by the late 1920s, following visits to Europe by three African-American journalists, black Berliners were in active correspondence with a handful of African-American newspapers, something that's evidenced by Victor Bell's 1930 letter to the Baltimore Afro-American. So by the late 1920s then, the networks that Germany's black population were involved in were truly transnational in reach. Black Germans were part of what Robin Keeley has called a black diasporic vision that was in development, a vision that they were also actively contributing to. It shouldn't surprise us that black residents would utilize theatre as a means of activism and as an expression of identity. Increasingly shut out of normal routes of employment, by the late 1920s, most had turned to performance, whether on the stage, the screen, or in the circus, as a way of making a living. Of the six founding members of the League, five were experienced performers, as were the majority of members. Employment as a performer, although often seasonal and unstable, could be financially lucrative. Jazz, revue shows, and black performers in general were particularly fashionable in Germany from the mid-1920s. US global stars such as Josephine Baker, Paul Robeson, and the Sam Wooding Orchestra all appeared in the Berlin stage, and black Germans appeared alongside them. At the same time, typically the roles that black German entertainers were expected to perform reflected continuing stereotypes of the black as primitive or exotic, reinforcing ideas of white European superiority and black inferiority. They were often asked to act out popular white fantasies of savagery and primitive physicality. And by the late 1920s, a conservative backlash against both black performers and black cultural forms was well underway. This was signalled, amongst other things, by Turing's Nazi Minister of the Interior and Education, Wilhelm Frick's decree against so-called Negro culture in 1930. multiple right-wing commentators bemoaned the popularity of jazz, and there's clear evidence of white performers insisting that they be given preferential treatment when competing for jobs. Meanwhile, the Neue Zeitschrift für Musik, in a scathing piece on black performers in general, picked up on and scoffed at the idea of the League's plans for staging their own review show. So what of Sonnenaufgang in Morgenland? It was the Cameroonian baby in Pisa, better known under his stage name of Lewis Brody, who was behind the theatre project. Described in several newspapers as an educated writer and actor, Brody was without doubt the most successful of the black German performers. Born in Douala in 1892, Brody had first come to Germany around 1912, and he was already appearing in feature films as early as 1915, when he took a leading role in the detective film Gesetzte Mine, directed by the pioneering Austrian director Joe May. Within a short period of time, Brody had established himself as a successful and increasingly well-known actor. In 1922, while in Vienna, for filming of Heinz Harnes's Homo Sum, he was featured in the front cover of the Austrian cinema weekly Die Filmwelt. The corresponding profile piece described him in a mixture of demeaning exoticized stereotypes and genuine praise. I quote, "Brody is a striking figure, probably one of the most splendid of his race, tall and muscular built, and gifted with an exceptional intelligence to represent various exotic roles in film." Already he had distinguished himself in numerous films, enjoyed great popularity, and according to Die Filmwelt, was one of the most sought-after Berlin actors. By 1930, Brody had appeared in dozens of films, including Herren der Welt, Metropolis, and Der Müde Tod, working with the likes of directors Robert Wiener, Fritz Lang, Alfred Hitchcock, and actors such as Konrad Veidt, Hans Albers, Peter Lorre, Lil Dagova, and Lillian Harvey. He'd also featured in the successful 1926 touring review show Black People, alongside the African-American dancer Lewis Douglas. With increasingly diminishing employment opportunities for black Germans, even within the sphere of entertainment, Brody would have been more than aware that a successful review show could offer crucial income for his financially struggling compatriots. Moreover, however, Brody would also know that in developing their own productions, black Germans would be able to reclaim their image by appropriating the power of representation, enabling them to break free from the restricted roles that they were expected to play. An initial report suggested that Brody and his colleagues would first put on the play Porgy by the Americans Dorothy and DuBose Hayward. This had premiered in New York in 1927, and it focused on the lives of African Americans in South Carolina. But this didn't happen, and instead Brody developed his own show, which was much more in keeping with what black Germans wanted to tell about their own experiences. Brody's show deliberately sought to challenge entrenched, cliched images of Africa and discriminated representations of black people in circulation in Germany. It sought to deconstruct such stereotypes and explain their origins. So in Brody's show, there were to be no step dancers in giant top hats and no cross-eyed, jiggling banjo players singing teary refrains. Instead, Sonnenaufgang im Morgenland served to celebrate black history and culture. His wish, according to several reporters, was to show that black people were, I quote, just as good, bad, funny, and capable as white Europeans. And in the words of one reporter, to quote, that they are people just like us. This intention echoes a public statement Brody had made years earlier when writing an open letter in a Berlin newspaper, the Bitze am Mittag, in the name of black residents and in the context of the black shame propaganda. Brody had openly written, "We are not the immoral and uncultivated race as is now in Germany all too commonly claimed. Here too, in the letter and in the review show, there was clearly an educational purpose. The first half of the show, performed partly in an unspecified Bantu language, likely Douala, given the membership of the cast, was set around 1880, and it critically engaged with the impact of European colonialism on Africa, crucially from an African perspective. The second half, set in the present, so 1930, was performed in French, English, and German, demonstrating not just the language abilities of the performers, but also the multilingualism that was typical of diasporic communities. To cut down on costs, all the props and costumes were made by the performers themselves, while a Berlin artist helped with the design of the sets. The performers also functioned as directors and as stage managers. At least initially, they had hoped to recruit black performers for the United States, including members of the Blackbird Show, which had proved to be so successful in Paris the previous year. But this would be unsuccessful. Nonetheless, rehearsals began in mid-January, and photographs in various African-American newspapers show some of the cast members. This includes the German-born Helen Allen, sister of the well-known jazz musician Willy Allen, and also the Douala man, Otto Makubi. In all, the cast was composed of around 30 black male performers, 8 black female performers, and 3 white performers. It also included a jazz orchestra. The star was certainly Brody himself. At the beginning of December, Sudden Aufgang in Morgenland received its premiere at Klim's Ballroom in the Hasenheide Berlin-Neukölln, a venue with strong links to the workers' movement, and one which was apparently frequented by black Berliners. This, though, is when the archival information starts to let us down. 2 surviving photographs of opening night show Brody in full dress, surrounded by fellow performers. But just how often the review was staged, how it was received by Berlin audiences, all these things remain largely unknown, though it did draw some unwanted attention. The Nazi mouthpiece, the Völkische Beobachter, produced a scathing article expressing surprise at the very thought of a play centering an African culture being performed in Berlin. It's also clear that despite the League's hopes and Brody's hopes, the show did not mark the beginnings of a permanent black theatre company. Given how little we know about Sonnenaufgang Morgenland, what, if anything, can and should we make of it? This is something that I'm still trying to puzzle out, but I want to offer a couple of brief thoughts. Firstly, in the context of the time and the socioeconomic pressures that black Germans faced, I think the very fact that they successfully developed and staged their own review show, constructed to challenge increasingly entrenched anti-black stereotypes, is remarkable. The group behind the play, the League, provides evidence of the diasporic consciousness of black Germans. Their sense of connectedness and solidarity with one another and with people of African heritage well beyond Germany's borders. We see this in terms of the networks that the League was involved in, but also in terms of their intentions for their race theatre. They retained a connectedness to their homelands and sought to develop a positive image of Africa and of people of African heritage. And in attempting to reclaim and shape their own representation, the show should be read as an example of black German activism and resistance. Linked to this, the show should further be seen as another example of black German collective self-help strategies. The theatre project sought to create sustainable employment opportunities, but the historical timing was against black Germans, and ultimately it failed. We can, though, perhaps see its imprint on the later venture, the part vaudeville, part ethnographic show die Deutsche Afrika Show, the German African Show. Created around 1934 and made up of many of members of the Son Aufgang cast and of the League, it too drew on Black Germans' performance abilities in order to secure jobs. By this time, however, with the Nazis now in power, the extent to which they could control their self-image and use performance as a form of resistance was greatly limited. Now, there was far greater public and state pressure to fulfill audiences' expectations of the exotic and primitive Black Other. In tailoring the content to be more in tune with the hopes of German colonial revisionism, in the short term at least, the Deutsche Afrika Show, the German Africa Show, would prove to be more successful. But Sonnenaufgang Morgenland gives an insight into Black culture productions that might have been, to Black activism, and to Black resistance. And as such, it is worthy of trying to recover this history.
Kupti tempelinqua, hare kupti, kupti tempelinqua, ngaba kunhom kaka, tsana erangai, ngaba kunhom kaka, tsana erangai. Hare kupti, kupti tempelinqua. Hare kupti, kupti tempelinqua. Ngaba kunhom kaka, tsana erangai. Ngaba kunhom kaka.
Yeah, wow. So yeah, so if you can just give us a little bit of your tale and your offerings.
Yeah, my offerings are multilingual in Swahili, English, and German, and they may be some translations, they may not be some translations, but basically it's about the transitioning of the message that I got through these waves as well. And I feel like these waves are gonna be transmitted in the right way, either way, even if there's no translation at all. So yeah, I have four different chapters, and also remembering, or yeah, as a remembrance of Bokero, the snake god, Hongo, the snake ghost medium, and Kinjikitile Ngwale. So this is, I'm dedicating this to the spiritual realms of our ancestors.
Die Faszinierung unserer Stimmen. Klangkunst unter Wasser. Ein Vermächtnis. Die Fabrizierung in Schwarz, dekoloniale Kontinuitäten, ein Struwwelpeter-Ende. Entwirren von Afrolocken, Entwurzelung des Ichs, Entdeckung kolonialer Erbe, Schwerpunkt Übernahme.
Okay, can you just introduce yourself, like, briefly?
Yes, of course. My name is Jumoke Adeonju, and I am a storyteller, a poet, translator, and a linguist, a polyglot, as well as a dancer, and I'm into sound art as a DJ, vinyl DJ, and sometimes I curate events.
Okay, great. Yes. The sound that you're hearing in the background is Tsi Kekehai, which is the beginning of tales. Usually in Khoekhoe Kovap, or Khoekhoe Kovap speakers use that as their beginning to enter into, you know, the story world. Right. And I found it very interesting. Gugiwa Thiong'o, in his Decolonizing the Mind, The Politics of Language, speaks about this oral tradition, you know, in Africa. And he speaks about how the oral tradition is only relevant if we can relate it to our present and to our future, right? And so the oral tradition somehow can guide us or make us understand the world that we're living in, but also understand our past and so on. And I was particularly interested in the story that you just told me earlier. If you could just like speak on that a little bit,
right.
Especially thinking about the kind of coincidences today, and we can unpack that a little bit later once you tell us the story that you, that you just.
So basically, I was very inspired by the sound, the specific sound that I was hearing while Robert Machiri was just playing around with the sounds and the, you know, your voice as well. And I started writing because I really like to write as a response to music, as a response to sound. And the first thing that came into my mind was the Maji Maji Rebellion in 1905 in Tanzania against the Germans. That time it was under German rule, and then the British took over later on. So basically, I had this crazy parallel vision of the Maji Maji Rebellion being also seen as like the water. In German, you say Wasserbändiger. Mm-hmm. In Avatar, you had like different elements. You had the earth, fire, air, and the water. And water also just as a way of a powerful tool to fight against people who have actual, like, material, you know, weapons, and seeing that as a magical way to defend yourself and your dignity as well.
Mm-hmm.
And even today, the meaning of water and the meaning of possessions, you know, in all realms, and spiritual realms, and material realms, and capitalistic realms. So yeah, for me, when I started writing, I thought, okay, let me concentrate on Tanzania in the context of Germany as well. And I just remembered there was this story on how the Maji Maji War actually started, which traces back to this spiritual entity, that the entity of like the Bantu myth and the Bantu legends, or just like stories of different gods that exist in the Bantu history.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this snake god called Bokero. And the snake god cannot be seen by human eye. So basically, it's this snake god is to be believed based in the Pangani River. It's close to Tanga in Tanzania.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also where the war was started, the Maji Maji War. And basically, Bokero, because this snake god can't be seen by human eye, needs a medium to communicate, or to possess a human body as a vessel to fight this war, right? And in my story that I'm gonna elaborate as a poetical, I guess like as a poem, it's about taking the position of Bokero, the snake god. So basically, Bokero called out on Hongo, which is the spirit medium, the snake ghost, to possess Kinjikitile Ngwale. And this is a person who actually existed. This was the leader of the Maji Maji War in 1905. This war lasted like 2 years. And he was the one who said, who actually held like political speeches, who was motivating the people to like get off the cotton and fight Theodor von Hassel, the German colonizers at that time, and to go on and use the water as a weapon
and the water was like mixed with castor oil and millet seeds, and he said, this is the power of the gods. With this one, we can actually defeat them.
Es ist der 10. Juli 2019, Mittwoch, früher Nachmittag, 21 Grad, untropisches Berlin, Deutsch-Ostafrika, vor 114 Jahren, Juli 1905. Ein Rückblick. Afro-revolutionäre Aufstände, Madi-Madi, Wasserbändiger, Wiederverwendung spiritueller Macht, Bokero, der Schlangengott im Pangani-Fluss, unsichtbar im Diesseits, ruft Hongo, den Schlangengeist, Vermittler zwischen Bokero und Mensch. Verweile im Körper von Kinji Kitile Ngwale, führe den Maji-Maji-Krieg aus, verjage die Deutschen von unserem Land, denn die Wasserwellen sind erzürnt.
So because of this, people actually believed that the Maji Maji, the water, can defeat the Germans. And he was executed by the Germans because he was the one leading the people to fight. You know, if this actually really helped or not, it's not even the case of the story. The case of the story is that the war happened and the rebellion was continued. And the message of Bokero was actually passed through to the people. Mm. And even after Kinji Kitile Ngwale's death, the Maji Maji war, the Maji Maji rebellion had like a great impact on the people. It just like infected this will to rebel against the colonizers. And yeah, this is like very inspiring because thinking of the Bokero living in the water, you know, and the Hongo as a medium spirit, and also Kinji Kitile Ngwale as the vessel, like the whole dimensions going through to actually pass on the message and make it reality. Mm. So like what Ngugi Thiong'o was saying, like the way story tales, you know, coming from that Bantu myth, like to reality is. Yeah, like the I guess like this thin line of fantasy and reality can just like just yeah, fade away. Yeah, yeah, evaporate in that instant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Begin poetischer Beitrag. Nimesao rangi ya ukoloni, na mfuko ya maafa sokoni, nisame. I forgot the color of colonialism and the bags of genocide at the market. Forgive me. Ich vergaß die Farbe des Kolonialismus und die Tasche des Genozids auf dem Markt. Forgive me. Walibadilisha jina lako, Tawala Shinalako Nisamehe. They changed your name to become the masters of your roots. Forgive me. Vergiss nicht die Farbe des Kolonialismus und die Taschen des Genozids am Markt und zu überleben. To survive. Kuishi.
Yeah, it's interesting how you're talking about the different realms, because even other battles that took place during that time, say for example in Namibia, the resistance heroes also had spiritual leaders who came and protected them during the resistance war. Mm. So there almost is this, always when you speak about these historical narratives, this idea of myth and history kind of being intertwined. But it also points to this idea about how history is continuous, yeah, that myth and history live alongside each other, and you almost have to, and that these realms continue. Like, imagine there's like a medium between the past and the present, and that this story still continues into the present, into the future. So it's like never ending, it's continuous.
Yeah.
So yeah, I like that aspect as well, thinking about thinking about these transitions and how those myths also reflect on right now.
Right.
Yeah.
And speaking of right now, like, it's July. And when I just Googled just to check on that I'm actually getting the dates right, I was like, wait, this happened in July 1905. And then you told me that you read an article.
I read an article this morning talking about... It's actually an article that was sent by Flower Manasseh. She's a curator at the National Museum in Tanzania.
Ah,
and she works... She also works on this period of German colonization. And she sent an article saying that Tanzania is now demanding Germany... reparations from Germany for the Maji Maji War. So
see?
It's some very interesting coincidences that we've been having in the studio, listening to Robert's sound, water sounds.
Yes.
Then
and
connecting
then from there.
It with. Yeah. And then the water sounds were actually a recording from East Africa that he was playing
from
with.
From Burundi.
From
was
Burundi,
it? Yeah.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. That he was playing with. So, and then you came with your.
The Maji
Maji. And so it all coalesced together very well right here in the studio. And
yeah, this is just, I guess, like the spiritual realms just coming into reality in the present, you know, like, and also like just in the future, because even this recording right now, people are listening to it in September or so.
Yes, yes.
So basically, it's like
it'll live on.
Into,
it'll live on, just like the myths. Yeah.
Right, it's really beautiful.
Mimi ni Mama Kosa. Nimekosea kucheza, kucheka, kuchemsha asili. Ich habe den Honig unserer Herkunft verkocht. You know the secret of this tragedy. Mimi ni Mama Kosa. Haftung im Geheimnis des Traumas. Nimepita, nitachagua Shatupori, nitapita peke yangu, wengine wameshafariki njiani. Das Erwachen unserer Vorfahren, die Faszinierung unserer Stimmen, Klangkunst unter Wasser. Die Reinkarnation vom Schlangengott Bokero, sichtbar im Jenseits. Kinjikitele Ngwale. Next time when you hear voices, remember the rage of the water waves. Na kuishi, kuishi, kuishi. Ich heiße Jumoke Adeonju. Ich bin nigerianisch-deutsche Poetin, Polyglotte. Multilingual auch unterwegs, also schreibe auf Kiswahili, auf Englisch, Deutsch und Yoruba. Ich bin Kuratorin, ich bin Tänzerin und bin auch DJ.
Describe the ability of voice to mark place and place to give sound its gravitas yet not contained by it as its spectrality and agency. Voice comes from other worlds to tell us of those worlds, to fetch and carry between worlds as a multi-directional repossession. We focus on how myths, songs, and reenactments sonically reinvent the everyday. The land becomes a sacralized soundscape of beings from the other world. Here, an alternative archive is continuously remade. Sure.
Oh,
We reflect on listening practices by turning to South African jazz vocalist Satima Bia Benjamin. We tune into how her experiences influenced her voice. Benjamin said she carried a melancholic voice because it came from a long lineage of sadness, and thus no one had the ability to make her sad. This echoes with geographies of historical catastrophe, yet grounded in varied practices of freedom. The figure of Benjamin intersects with our own experiences of place in the region and creates polyvocal positions. Her intimate commitment to storytelling inspires us as she forms an integral part of our sonic homecoming. We position Benjamin with Princess Magogo, Stella Chiweshe, and Lena Fenter because of their generation's complex translation of indigenous instrumentation and their transnational navigation over generations from St. Helena Island between Southern Africa and Brazil and their exiles in Europe. We loop their voices to distinctively mark the role of women as storyteller, educator, pioneer of modern recording, and matriarchal divine force. We perform these intersecting playbacks to interrogate the limits of hegemonic archives. The recording's acoustic excess moves beyond regional, linguistic, musical, and bodily representations and point to other forms and spaces of sonic inscription and mobility. We search for incidental moments when two forms, which may seem dissonant, become flashes of synchronicity. The remix methodology points to versionings, implicit in listening practices of storytelling and other oral performances. This is an act capable of infinite polyphonic forms. We explore a relational sonority, a multi-directional future-present time between historical and contemporary recordings. We understand that this not only reframes the archive, but also transforms our sense of the world.
Thank you.
Zangaradzimu are beings as told through the Shona experience of the supernatural world. These shadow people come to haunt the living. They are malevolent spirits who live in the recesses of lush forests and are described as tall beings whose faces are invisible as their bodies stretch to the heavens. They appear and repossess the voice and memory of humans. This devouring renders the human immobile and intervenes in their ability to divine their future. Dzimu Dzangara, the inversion of Dzangara Dzimu, refers to a radio. Sound here is inscribed from the human who is dispossessed of voice and memory and in turn transferred to the idea of a machine with disembodied voices. These transmissions create a range of listening practices. The mobility and temporality of voice and its ability to possess various bodies and forms is what Pungwe expands on. We thereby begin to trace and locate transmissions where there is an excess of the acoustic in the archive of the everyday. Ti Igege Ha'e is the opening of a tale retold by Lena Fenter, recorded in Okahandja, Central Namibia in 1954. The master narrator Lena moves effortlessly between the voice of the protagonist and other actors in the story. Her voice carries the suspense, the sly haughtiness of the dog monster, the commanding and unsympathetic master, and the dread and angst of a woman in danger. The story recounts a man and woman walking in the veld. The couple find a dog and take it home. The woman notices the dog has human eyes, does not eat the meat they throw it, and talks while dreaming. She repeatedly complains to her partner, who merely ignores her and sleeps. At night, the dog transforms into a monster and eats the man. The woman, who had smeared soot and ash on her body before she slept to protect herself, wakes up to the dog eating her partner. She runs away at dawn and climbs a tree. The dog monster chases her and makes a fire at the base of the tree. Each time the monster lights the fire, the woman pees on and extinguishes it. This lighting and extinguishing continues until the woman spots three figures with dogs in the distance. She calls for them. They run towards her and tear the monster apart. The woman climbs down the tree and follows them home. The tale is heard as an account of how a woman protects herself from a life-threatening force. While showing itself to be benevolent, it is actually ready to devour him. She instinctively knows that if she ignores the danger, it will be fatal. She protects and guards her body. However, it is a little too late, as she has already let it enter her interior space. She must wander into her wild nature and draw up her strength, account for the losses, and cut off the destroying force. It is essential that she listens to and thereby awakens her guardians. These guardians intercede on her behalf, destroy the force, and lead her home. Numerous tales of spectral beings exist, in the form of dog monsters, men with eyes on their feet, women with three eyes, ghost women with the face of an animal, maidens who turn men into trees, women and men who transform into non-human beings. The story as myth unfolds as an initiatory myth. It forms part of a greater origin nexus and reflects the philosophy, language, relations, value system and cosmology of its origins. It is an archival trace, a listening to a listening to an oral memorial genealogy in deep time.
Tira ka ru, niara kesi ariye ke ho. Tira ke ngati ke kung kung kung, tira ka uru, niara kesi ariye ke ho. Tira aisa iran kuema e. Hi, tira mioke awa, ai ariye ta.